How does a Formula One engine work? The engine, which is called power unit, is so complex that I will be doing 6 videos about the topic. The first one, this one, about the internal combustion engine. Then we talk about the turbo and the MGU-H. Third video, MGU-K, MGU-H. Fourth video, the battery. Fifth video, the energy management. And the last video about the engine history and the fuel consumption. We will see in detail each of these components, see how they work, and I will also show you a power unit model developed by the Politecnico of Milano, which is the Italian university. To make you understand how much we studied for this video, we bought a magazine from Japan with some information that you can find only there, and I will show you some interesting stuff. So if you like Formula One, subscribe now in order to be notified when the next episode will come out. So let's start. First of all, why do we say power unit instead of engine? Because since 2014, in Formula One, there is not anymore one single engine, but there are 3 engines. The first one is the internal combustion engine, called ICE. It is a combustion engine conceptually similar to those we find in the road cars, but with some very, very important differences. This engine has also a turbocharger, which we will see in the second episode. The second engine is an electric engine called MGU-H, which stands for Motor Generator Unit Heat. This engine is connected to the turbocharger, and we'll see it in the second episode. And the third and final engine is the MGU-K, which stands for Motor Generator Unit Kinetic. It's also an electric engine, but which is connected to the crankshaft, and we will see it in the third episode. So today we see the first of these 3 engines. So how is this internal combustion engine made? The Formula One regulation states that it has to be a 6-cylinder, 1600cc, with a 90-degree angle between the 2 cylinders banks. And the 2 banks are basically the 2 sides of the engine. We have 3 cylinders in one and 3 cylinders in the other one. And considering that they make a V corner, that's why the engine is called V6. And this V structure is not common in the road cars, because they are usually the cylinders are placed vertically, and that's why those engines are called inline. So why did they choose a V engine in Formula One? Basically for geometry and dynamic issues, because a V engine has a lower center of mass and is more compact, all things that improve the performance of the car. Now, I will give you a quick explanation of how an internal combustion engine works. Many of you will probably know this stuff, but pay attention to it because I will tell you some very important details that you probably may not know and which will make a big difference in the Formula One engines. So inside the engine, you have the pistons, which move up and down. And by moving up and down, they make rotate the crankshaft, which will make rotate all the gears in the gearbox, which will make rotate the differential, and in the end will make spin the wheels, therefore moving forward the car. So we understood that everything starts from the piston. And the piston has a head that tends to be circular, and the diameter of the circle is called bore, while the distance that the piston makes between the top dead center and the bottom dead center is called stroke. If we multiply the area of the bore by the height of the stroke, we get a cylinder, okay? And the volume of the cylinder, if we multiply it by 6 cylinders, we get the total displacement of the engine, which is 1600cc. So why did I mention the bore and the stroke? Because they are very important in Formula One. Because by regulation, the bore is said to be 80 millimeters, while the stroke is said to be 53 millimeters. So you can see that this cylinder is more wide than tall. So because of this, the Formula One engines are defined over square. And why is that? Because an over square engine can reach higher RPMs. So just to give you a reference, a normal road car goes up to 6,000 RPM. A Formula One of the Schumacher era could reach 20,000 RPMs, while a modern Formula One reaches usually 12,500 RPMs. So mostly all the road cars are under square. Even the supercars like the Lamborghini Huracan, only the sports cars that want to reach super high RPMs, or the motorbikes like the Ducati Panigale V4 are over square. So now that we know the shape of the Formula One engine, how does an engine work? So what is it that moves the pistons? The fuel, you may say. Okay, I know these things might seem obvious for the experts, but trust me, listen to them, because some things will not be obvious. The Formula One engine is a 4-stroke engine, which means the cycle has 4 strokes. The first stroke is called intake stroke, where basically the piston goes down, and by going down, the air valve opens and it sucks air into the cylinder. And at this point, the gasoline engines are divided in two classes.
We have the port injection engines,
where the air that is sucked into the cylinder is already mixed with fuel. One example is the engine of my Euro NASCAR, which is a carburetor engine, where the air petrol mixture is already made by the carburetor. And then we have the direct injection engines, where the injector sprays the gasoline inside the cylinder. And the gasoline is not injected in the intake stroke, but is injected in the second phase, which is the compression stroke. And this is what happens in most modern engines and what happens in the Formula One engines. So, in direct injection engines, the air is sucked with fuel in the first stroke. Direct injection engine, the fuel is injected in the second stroke. So, what happens in this second stroke, which is called the compression stroke? The piston, by going up, when the piston starts to go up, the intake valve closes, so the piston starts to compress the air inside the cylinder. So, what happens now? It happens that when the piston reaches the upper dead point, the air and fuel mixture is so compressed and so hot that just a single spark would ignite it. And so, what do? We ignite it by using the spark plug. So when it ignites, it creates a small explosion inside the cylinder, which pushes the piston down, releases a lot of energy, and makes the car move. And this third stroke of the piston going down is called the expansion stroke. Then, when the piston goes up again, the exhaust valve is opened and the exhaust gases are thrown out of the engine. So, this cycle is ready to start again. Now, for the very experts, in Formula 1, any system of varying valve timing or valve lift is prohibited. Which is curious if you consider how much variable timing techniques are used in the road cars. So, the one that we just saw is the gasoline engine. So, as you have seen, the specific feature of the gasoline engine is that it burns a homogeneous mixture of air and fuel. And what do I mean with homogeneous? I mean that the air and the fuel are perfectly mixed. You know, it's like when you put the sugar into the tea and start to spin it with a spoon, it gets perfectly mixed. And one other very important thing of the gasoline engine is the timing. I mean, the spark, made with the spark plug, must be done in a very specific time. Because otherwise, the engine might become uncontrollable and create phenomena like the knock, which might break the engine. And that's why we have the spark plug, to control this timing. And that's why the gasoline engine should also be called spark ignition engines. Now, as you know, there are also the diesel engines. And why am I talking about this? Because you will see in a moment that the Formula One engines take some characteristics from the gasoline engine and some others from the diesel engine. Yeah, it might sound crazy, but it's like that. So, as you probably know, the diesel engines don't have the spark plug.
And that's why they're called compression ignition engines.
But the question is, how does the mixture ignite if there is no spark? So, just a note for the engineers out there, I'm oversimplifying everything to make it comprehensible to normal people, so keep that in mind. So, in the diesel engine, the injector ignites the fuel right at the end of the compression stroke, where the air is so compressed that as soon as the fuel touches the air, it ignites spontaneously. So, as you can probably understand, in the diesel engine, we have not an homogeneous mixture, but we have an heterogeneous mixture, because the diesel is injected at the end of the compression stroke. And you can see it clearly from these three images, which are three photos of three sequential moments of the ignition. Look at the first one. You can see those flames. That is the injector injecting the fuel into the cylinder, which immediately sets on fire. And then the other two photos are the two following moments of the ignition. Okay, now will come the crazy stuff. Because we know how the gasoline engine works. We know how the diesel engine works. And the Formula One engine, it is a mix of the two. Because it uses a different type of combustion, which is so powerful that you can get 820 horsepower from a 1600cc engine. So the Formula One engines follow the principle called homogeneous charge compression ignition, which is HCCI. And the basic idea is simple, to combine the pros of the gasoline engine with the pros of the diesel engine. So, the mixture is homogeneous like in the gasoline engine. That means that the injector injects the fuel in the compression stroke. Not at the end, but at the beginning. But the piston compresses the mixture so much that it will ignite spontaneously like in the diesel engine. And why do you want to bring it to that critical condition? Because if you compress it so much that it will ignite spontaneously, the combustion is so powerful that you can get more performance from the engine. And how do you get that? With a higher compression ratio. For example, road car Fiat Panda, it has a compression ratio of 9. The Ferrari Formula 1 of Schumacher had a ratio of 13, while a modern Formula 1 has a compression ratio of 18, which is huge. So, the big problems that the engineers had to face is we want to compress the mixture so much that it ignites spontaneously. But how do we control the ignition timing? The idea is simple, we can use the spark. But if we use the spark, it means it's not igniting spontaneously. So, how do we choose the right timing without using the spark, but by using the spark? And it seemed like a paradox, until somebody invented the pre-chamber, which is the magical trick of the Formula One engines. So this is a concept 100 years old, because it has been patented in 1920 for diesel engines, when they created a casing around the spark plug. This casing has a series of holes in it, like, you know, those things that you use to make the tea, okay? So this pre-chamber created around the spark plug is connected to the cylinder with those holes. So this is what happens. When the injector injects the fuel inside the cylinder, while the piston is compressing the air, some of that fuel enters those holes and goes around the spark plug, creating a very rich of fuel area around the spark plug. So when the spark plug creates the spark, that fuel around the spark plug is ignited, and instantly some throes of flames comes out of the holes of the pre-chamber. These flames enter the cylinder, where we have the air and fuel mixture which is ready to explode. So those flames ignite the mixture and we create that spontaneous ignition that we were looking for. So by doing this, we get what Honda calls high-speed combustion, which is a very fast and efficient and powerful combustion. So what you see here are the Formula One spark plugs, which is taken from the magazine that we got from Japan. The first one is an old Formula One spark plug. As you can see, there is no pre-chamber, just a spark plug. The second one is a modern Formula One spark plug with the pre-chamber. You can see it has been cut in half in order to let you see inside. And you see how tiny it is, the space inside the pre-chamber, and you see the holes in the bottom. Then in the third picture, you can see the cap with the holes that screws around the spark plug. While in the fourth one, you see the complete spark plug with the cap. So all of this makes you understand why the Formula One engine has a different combustion than the other engines and how you can get 820 horsepower from a 1600cc engine. Obviously, every single detail of the Formula One engine is so special that we can spend hours talking about it, but we don't want to do it. But I want to tell you another magical thing that happens in the Formula One engines. Since 2015, variable geometry intake trumpets can be used again in Formula One. Honda, for example, calls this system VIS, which stands for Variable Intake System. And what are these trumpets? So the principle is simple but fascinating. So do you remember when I explained what the intake stroke is, which is the stroke where the piston sucks the air inside the cylinder? So this stroke is very important in every engine, because it's like breathing. You know, when you're running, if you don't breathe properly, you will get exhausted soon. You cannot use your energy. And in the engine, it's the same. The better is the engine at sucking air, the more efficient and powerful it will be. That's easy to say, but it's difficult to do, and I will explain you why. I don't know if you ever saw it, but do you have any idea how fast an engine moves? Look at this. Have you seen how fast it is? So all these movements up and down that makes the valve open and close, open and close, open and close, creates some waves in the tubes before the intake valve. So that air is not still, but it keeps bouncing back and forth. So if those pressure waves of the air are not synchronized with the valve opening, the result is that not enough air will be sucked into the cylinder. Because if the air is pushing back and the valve is opening, not all the air is entering the cylinder. So how do you synchronize those air movements with the valve? Because the higher the RPMs go, the faster the air starts to bounce. So in order to fix this issue, it's not enough to design the pipes properly, but you should have some pipes that change length according to the RPMs of the engine. So what did they do? They started using some telescopic tubes which change length depending on the RPMs. So I don't know if you got it, but when the RPMs go up, those intake tubes get shorter, while when the RPMs go down, they get longer to adapt to the bouncing of the air inside the tubes. Tell me if this is not magic. So basically, this is how a Formula One internal combustion engine works. And this was just the first episode. We still need to talk about the turbo, the MGU-H, MGU-K, battery, energy management, all things that will be discussed in the next episode. If the episode is already out, you will find it linked in the description. If it's not, subscribe to the channel and click the bell to get notified. Thanks for watching and get ready to know more about the turbo and the MGU-H.